In terms of in-game responsibilities, which is another big area I wanted to take a look at, this was a huge departure for us when we switched to the system. When I say departure, I really just mean a change. And I think for head coaches out there, you should think about having a really clearly defined role for each assistant coach. And maybe you already have that, but I a little bit get the impression that for teams that play a more traditional style, at least at the college level, what it seems like to me is you maybe have a grad assistant or two that are keeping a specific stat, but a lot of times then you maybe have two or three assistants that are kind of just doing the same thing that the head coach is doing to some respect. And I think that that's a little bit of a shame, because you can get more value out of your assistants, in my opinion, if they have a really specific role. And in the system, because everything is happening so quickly, that's of elevated importance. So a couple of things to think about depending on the size of your staff. Here's some sample roles for your assistants. You got to have one guy that is sending in the next shift. I mean, probably if you're the head coach, you don't want to do that. I would really advise against it, unless you're really, really taking a hands-off approach, so much so that you don't want to, you know, see the game as much. You need to have a person that is tracking whatever team goals you have. So as Coach Barber said, we've tweaked these, but pretty consistently we've stuck with the traditional from the coaching the system book: 100 shots, 50 threes, 25 more shots than the opponent, 35% offensive rebound, and forcing the opponent to 32 turnovers. So having a way for someone to keep that stat. Another really important one is you need to have a coach that can talk with a group collectively as they come off the court. And maybe that is the head coach. But again, the shifts are so short that if that is the head coach, you run the risk of talking to the group and literally missing the entire next shift of what's going on and having no idea what went on in their shift. So, and it could be a person that is relational. So we have a couple of guys on our staff that are really good relationally assistant coaches that are just kind of a calming presence, because the system is such a high energy person. Or it can be a person that is literally, a lot of times what happens with our groups is they come off the court, they go right past the bench, and they go down to get a cup of water. And that's a great opportunity, just if you can collect yourself and give them one or two specific pieces of information in that 20 to 30 seconds, that can be really valuable for them. We oftentimes, this last year, oftentimes at the start of the game, we would give our GA the assignment of looking at the other team's press break. So normally, if a team has prepped for you, they have spent a pretty tremendous amount of time that week with their press break. And normally, that means that they have a pretty rigid system that if you can figure out what it is that they're trying to do, you can adjust your press potentially, or take away what they're trying to do and make it a lot harder on them. So that normally takes, you know, 5, 6, 7 shifts to really get an idea of, okay, what's the movement? Who are they trying to throw the ball to? What's their next pass? But if you designate, since the press is such a critical element of the system, if you designate an assistant coach, I just want you to take the first 5 minutes of the game and I want you to know what the press break is. That's worth your time. And maybe after that first 5 minutes, you go on to a different thing that you want to study, you know, what they're doing on their half court defensive coverage, or once they break the press, you know, generally, what are they trying to do offensive scheme wise? And then